Yeah, welcome to this video part 18 of the pre-World Championship match series. Now presenting a game again of the challenger Magnus Carlsen. And in fact, it's a game that shows the last challenger for the world title, Boris Gelfand, playing against Carlsen. So we have a nice meeting of World Championship challengers. This was played in November 2011 in the Tal Memorial. And at the time, Gelfand already was the challenger for the 2012 match. And Carlsen didn't participate in this cycle. And let's get to the game. Playing d4 here, Magnus. I think I'm not quite sure if I showed any non-e4 games of his. I'm not quite sure in this series. He mostly plays e4, but still there's also a good amount of d4. He's basically playing any opening. Okay, Gelfand now defends here with the Slav defense. He has I was about to say a limited repertoire, but this is not so true anymore. He introduced the Grunfeld to his repertoire for the World Championship match, and besides the Slav, he can also play the Queen's Gambit Declined. Yeah, so the Slav was certainly something to be expected among the things that he had played before. Yeah, Carlsen plays e3 here, the oftentimes called slow Slav. It's indeed a bit slow, blocking this bishop, but it provides a solid cover of the c4 pawn, and we see one idea in the following line. Gelfand plays bishop f5, which is one of the main moves. If black plays e6 here, then one idea of this move order is that white has not yet committed the knight to c3, and therefore can also think about setups like this, just to show the general idea. This kind of idea is a possible setup with the knight on d2 so that it can support its colleague on e5. One idea of this e3 move. But bishop f5 is one of the main moves, as mentioned. And now Carlsen goes for knight c3, e6, and knight h4, which is a well-known line that has a very solid reputation for black, but also the reputation of being just a little bit better for white. This bishop is has a hard time to not get exchanged for the knight. In fact, black here has various possibilities to move the bishop. Can play bishop e4, bishop g4, all of those moves. Gelfand plays the simplest move, just to g6, where white will capture. White does not necessarily need to capture immediately, but Carlsen goes for that. Just give me the bishop pair. And now he played bishop to d3. Yeah, this is one of the possibilities, not a very common one. In fact, the way he's playing here is relatively rare, but it's still an impossible line. Bishop d3, knight d7, castles, bishop d6, h3. And this is, as mentioned, not so popular for white, simply because, yeah, this is an open file, and you have played h3. So on a very good day, black will get to sacrifice on h3, or maybe push the g-pawn to open the h-file. So this is slightly controversial way of playing, as white can easily get under some attack. And we see in the game that indeed this happened. What should black play here? Gelfand now decided to clarify things in the center, and I think this is justified. He took on c4. What black needs to be cautious with is that white does not get a complete clamp on the position. Let's say, for example, a slow move like queen e7, you need to reckon with these kind of ideas where black cannot play e5 and is just pushed back here on the queen side in the near future. Also, you can ask yourself, what is black's king doing? Castling short does look wrong, castling long even more so. So this is not what black should do. He took on c4 and played e5. Oh, sorry, first this knight move and then e5. And this makes sure that there is no clamping down with f4. Black frees up his game. But on the other hand, of course, it looks like the position will open up. And this is basically what white is looking forward to, because he's got the two bishops and you'd like to open up the position. Yeah, Carlsen now plays a simple looking but interesting move. He played queen to c2. And the idea is that now black has no way of getting castle short, because after short castles, white has a nice shot, can just capture this pawn. The very common motif in the Slav, where this pawns, this double pawn is quite often occurring, and the bishop on b3 and the queen on g6. This is a common motif, so easily spotted by Gelfand. But those little ideas can alter the course of the game. The course of the game tremendously, because now black is basically forced to castle long or to somehow stay in the center with the king. You can consider a move like this. It's not completely insane. You can continue with queen e7 and using this rook, and this rook is in a way developed, but mostly black should try for castling long. And this is what Gelfand is doing. He went for queen e7, preparing long castles. Yeah, Carlsen played the little move, bishop d2. Simply, there is not much much else. You could consider a move like f4. This is interesting, but takes and long castles seems fine for black. For example, after f5, there's just bishop c7 attacking here and preparing this idea. So it's not too great. Just bishop d2 is completely fine. Yeah, and now Gelfand played long castles, which is by far the sharpest move. It's debatable. You don't need to play this, but it's just the most principled way to go about that. I'm not quite sure. Sometimes Gelfand in the chess media or chess forums has got this kind of reputation of being a relatively boring player. This is completely untrue. I'm not quite sure where people get to this conclusion, unless you think you need to sacrifice pieces every game incorrectly, then maybe this is right. But he's playing rather ambitious chess normally. It's not like it's completely dull, especially since he abandoned the Petrov. For a while he was playing the Petrov all the time, trying to kill the game as black against e4, but now he's gone back to the to the Sicilian mostly, and often has got very sharp games. So he's playing a much sharper chess than Carlsen, for example. No one does criticize him for playing boring, and sometimes he really plays boring games. I'm not saying bad games, it's just very technical chess, and Gelfand's chess is more enterprising usually. So it's really not justified to call him boring at all. Okay, so we see that this is not a boring game. Yeah, Carlsen plays d5 here, using the c file opposition of queen and king. And yeah, this initiates the following sequence, which is very sharp and had to be evaluated before, and otherwise white cannot afford this. You should take note that those pieces are all on the queen side, and white's king side is really deserted. There are no pieces. Yeah, not even a rook here, and I don't know, let's say a knight on f1 to cover stuff, or a bishop on f1. So we see after e4, this is what Galfond played, the sharpest move, takes, and queen e5, we see that black is really getting an attack here. You also needed to calculate rook takes h3. It's not completely crazy. I mean, it is, but you need to check it. Taking and queen e5. But white has got f4. This is important. You can
check
easily, go for this continuation. And this is not good at all for black. Let's consider this for a moment. And the queen is trapped. This you needed to see beforehand. So he played queen e5, not the rook sec, which is incorrect. But this has a very important point. White now has no alternative to f4. Yeah, must play that. Otherwise, it's an immediate disaster. Takes, rook takes, and now the very cute move, knight g4. And Carlsen, who did annotations himself for this game, admitted that he had overlooked this move when he played bishop d2 on move 14. Yeah, it's an easy to overlook move, because, and also there are many alternatives. Black also could have played this check, which is not stupid at all. Something like this is a possible continuation. And black has very interesting play here. It's hard to assess, though. Possible idea for black is even to use this rook on h5, get it into play in that way. However, Galfond's move, knight to g4, is perfectly alright, so we don't really need to look for improvements here. You can check alternatives, but it's not a bad move. We can check what happened.
Check.
White first took on b7 and king b8. Yeah, as usual, you want to play king b8 and not capture on b7, because the king is more exposed here. This is the general consideration. In fact, here,
check.
Queen e4 immediately wins for white, so he really needed to play king b8. Yeah, and now white has no choice. You need to take this funky knight, take on g4. And check. Now rook h1 check. Obviously, the point of all this. And at first it looks really, really really ugly for white. You, of course, cannot take. This is just a very quick mate. So king f2 and rook takes a1. So quite funny line that now we have on the board. Black managed to win the a1 rook with rook h1 to a1. You rarely see that. And yeah, how to assess this position? It's obviously really complicated. We see that from a material point of view, white's got 6 pawns, black's got 4 pawns, so white has 2 pawns for the exchange, for being the exchange down. And he's got the b7 pawn, and this is always tricky, this kind of pawn. It can be a decisive factor, it can be just lost. And yeah, all in all, this is a very unclear position. And we see that it is very difficult also to play. Yeah, Carlsen now plays the move knight to e2, which is probably a strong move. It helps in defense, covering g1, maybe intending knight g3 to cover f1. And it also prepares to activate the bishop on c3. So this is probably all right. And bishop c5, very natural move. Getting on this weakened pawn and putting the bishop just on this sensitive diagonal across the king. And Carlsen plays bishop c3, activating the bishop. Here, white had other ideas, could also, in fact, take the pawn. It's not out of this world to just take it, but at least to a forced sequence. At least it's a possible forced sequence to take on d2. Queen takes.
Check.
Bishop takes. And now the point.
Check.
And here, this position will probably end in a draw, though it's still complicated. The king positions are just too open here. White will always suffer from his king position, and black can hardly make any progress as long as the b7 pawn is on the board. And yeah, well, white is always covering that pawn. Probably a draw. Carlsen played bishop c3, as mentioned, also to avoid these kind of draws. Another idea was knight d4, and I must mention that because it, nope, not this one, threatens knight c6, but also would allow a draw. And as we know, Carlsen is always trying to keep the game going and fight. The draw is with rook takes d4, takes, and bishop check. Takes. Yeah, and now this is
check, check,
just forced.
Check.
Yeah, and no alternative here, just
check.
A perpetual check and a draw. Yeah, Carlsen always wants to fight. If there's any kind of possibility to keep the game going and set problems, he will do that. So, bishop c3. Gelfand responded to a queen to e7, perfectly all right. And now g5, a good move, fixing those pawns. And of course, fixing those pawns is a nice thing, but the position is so complicated. It's a matter of concrete lines. Yeah, what is the idea if black takes? White then plays queen e4, which is a very strong move. It activates the queen, covers b7, and if possible, allows queen f4. Yeah, for example, f5,
check.
Queen f4. And suddenly, white has a very good game. All pieces come to life. Especially the knight attacking g6 and maybe jumping to e6. So taking on g5 is probably not really to the point. What Gelfand played, I think, is just the most natural move. He played rook d2 d1. And here we have the really rare case where black has sort of doubled on the first rank. It really looks like the board is set up set up wrongly, like that there should be white rooks, but they're black's rook, black rooks on a1 and d1, and they really can get really annoying. Right now, rook f1 is a big threat, of course, and white really needs to cover this square on f1, so he went for knight g3. And bishop d6 back, trying to maybe get rid of this defensive piece. Yeah, Carlsen now played queen e2, again covering this square, and it's the only move. Knight e4 looks attractive at first, but runs into this move. Yeah, something check. Like that. Something like that. Just wins the house. Queen e2 was called for, and he played it. And now rook g1. This is playable, but a bit risky, and probably should be punished. It seems that the best move is bishop takes g3, but
check.
This kind of game is always difficult to really appreciate. if you use a computer for analysis. If you look at this game and you have a computer running, it just tells you the best moves, but play this over the board, it's terribly complicated to calculate all this. Bishop takes g3 here is a relatively straightforward way to play, though, for black. Probably Gelfand also was playing to fight and keep the game going. After this capture and rook takes, black can play
check
rook f1 to simplify things and something check. Like that. Intending knight to e5 will probably just equalize the game. But there's also very little that black can play for. He played rook g1 and this really keeps the game going. Here Carlsen missed the chance. He played queen to d3 and it seems that instead queen b5 was the better move. Though this is very difficult to figure out, of course, with the human brain only. It is just a more active move, and it involves lines like queen b7, queen e8 check, knight c8 and bishop c4, which again covers this and tries to activate this bishop along those lines, for example. And there's also rook f7 now, and this is completely insane. Rook f7, you need to be cautious with, g2 is saying. Yeah, the computer assesses this position as winning for white, but how are you going to do that in a game to recognize that? Very, very difficult. I even have a hard time to understand why. I now see bishop f1 is an additional idea, trapping this rook. Yeah, this is, for instance, a motif that a human is simply not going to see. Yeah, this is a possible line. Yeah, and black loses this rook basically. If he takes on g3,
check.
You take on g1. Crazy. Yeah, queen b5 was the better move, but queen d3 is a human move, and it's not bad in the sense that it leads to trouble, but it's very difficult to play this game perfectly. In fact, I think both players did an amazing job in this game to master those crazy complications. It's completely crazy to have those two rooks in your camp. I would probably suffer severe heart problems to play this game, or play this position. Yeah, okay, Gelfand played bishop c7, a logical move, keeping this bishop out of reach of the queen, securing it. And now knight e4 was played. It's still a position with dynamic equality. White just missed something with not playing queen b5, but it's still a bit, it's still about equal, this position. Here, Gelfand probably decided on a wrong plan. Now by the time it's of course a matter of remaining time, and of course the times here are nonsense that are shown here in ICC, but Gelfand seems to be that he already was in slight time trouble. He played rook f1. It seems that instead he should just stay, like a move like rook h1, continue and keep the tension. He played rook f1,
check.
Obviously trying to simplify a bit here, but this seems to strengthen white's position after g takes f3. One point is that he probably underestimated that the upcoming moves don't really trouble white, but this is this is tough to evaluate. He played f5. Yeah, and now queen h7. This is obviously what he calculated. He was thinking about entering the game with the queen. it's not a blunder or anything. F5, this was obviously planned, but it seems that it's really not a big deal. And Carlsen now plays perfectly, played queen to b5. The move that he had missed a couple of moves earlier now is again very strong. It intends queen to e8, amongst others, and it frees d3 for the king. This is, in fact, the key point. It seems that the next move now loses. Gelfand played rook g2 check with the somewhat crazy looking move a6. He had he could try to keep on resisting, but probably it wouldn't have been enough to save the game. After a6, queen a6, there's this counterplay, and this is enough for a draw. So a6 is a cute trick. Black, however,
check.
Also must check this move, and this is in fact the best move. After this check, Black takes another check, and then queen c6, intending this killing checkmate on b7. So Black needs to go for that.
Check.
And this, of course, is a very tough endgame to play. White has got two pawns for the exchange, excellent bishops, and this is an additional weakness. Probably Black will lose this endgame, but it's still a way to resist.
Check.
He played the rook check, and now White can simply go forward with the king. King d3, not being afraid of any ghosts. Black does not even have a check here. The only check is queen d7. Now this is in fact what was played. Black has no real alternative, as queen e8 is such a deadly threat.
Check.
So went here. Yeah, and now the funny point, bishop d5. This pawn, which all the time seemed doomed, and just a question of time until it is falling, is now the decisive factor. Note how nicely White's pieces coordinate. These bishops cover the pawns, knight covering the bishop. Everything's working nicely together, and even the king on d3 plays a useful role. Yeah, Gelfand played bishop e5. Now, if he captures on f6, there's this threat. So he needs to move the a pawn. And after this check, White can push the e-pawn with decisive effect. No way to stop both of those pawns. Yeah, he played bishop to e5. And yeah, here Carlsen, in fact, also probably being a bit short on time, plays an imprecise move. The easiest win now was to capture.
Check.
And play king d4 after knight d7. There's bishop c6. And this is the decisive move, as after a knight move, and it's hard to suggest anything else, there's knight c5 coming, and knight a6 is even a checkmate threat at the moment. Black has no way to prevent the pawn from promoting. This would have won easily. He played another move, which looks really cute, f4, but it's not the best one. Here Black could have put a stronger resistance, but being short on time, he played bishop to c7, which immediately loses. He could have played still bishop takes, knight takes, obviously attacking the rook, very funny maneuver. But here, in fact, Black can continue with the move knight c5 check. King d4. It still looks terrible with a double attack on both pieces, but there's rook c2. And now white doesn't have anything better than b4, knight takes, and knight d7 check. After which this pawn will fall, and white is probably winning anyway, but it's still a continuation of the game. The other one was clearer. Gelfand, however, played bishop c7 here, being short on time, and after bishop to c6, needed to resign. Yeah, this knight is attacked, and needs to move or take on f6, and just like before, this is deadly. In fact, here it's already a forced mate. The computer already shows a mate in 6 moves here. This is the immediate mate threat, and black cannot cover that. Also after this capture, there's, oops, not that one. Still knight moves to d7. Yeah, knight d7 is deadly here. No way for black to prevent that. A very nice and complicated game, showing that Carlsen is an excellent calculator. He's not only great in end games, as we saw before, but also excellent in calculating complicated positions. He didn't really intend to come under such heavy fire, but really kept a cool head, especially if you consider this kind of position where those rooks are invading white's position. You can easily make a mistake and get checkmated even quickly. This can easily happen if the opponent's pieces are so active. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed this game. Very complicated game. And there's only 2 games left in this series, and we are approaching the match itself. So not only a couple of days ahead till the first game is played, and I will provide, of course, daily game of the day coverage. I will not be able to do any live coverage, simply because of the time difference, which means that most of the games will be played when I'm at work in the office. So thanks for watching, and I'll be back tomorrow with part 19.